Hi, welcome to the fifth program in the Art in Arlington series. In this program, we meet with Kevin Duffy. Kevin Duffy is a sculptor who lives in Arlington, and you may have seen some of his works on display at the Arlington Center for the Arts, Waldo Park, and Spy Pond. I have to thank John Doyle, the subject of the third program in the series, for introducing me to Kevin. Even though Kevin hasn't been a sculptor for his entire life, he has been passionate about sculpting for his entire adult life, and that comes across clearly when you hear Kevin describe how he came back to the world of sculpting. Now, I've always appreciated, or at least I've always imagined, that sculpting is very hard work, and having seen just a brief demonstration of Kevin at work creating some of his sculptures has given me a real appreciation for the immense effort that goes into producing sculptures, both on a large scale and a small scale. I think you're going to enjoy meeting with Kevin and hearing about his life story and seeing some of his sculptures, both abstract and representational, on display. And as always, I thank you for watching. Kevin, thank you very much for joining me. So why don't you tell me a little bit about how you came to be a sculptor?
Okay, sure, Len. Well, I've been, to start a little bit at the beginning, I've always liked to draw and paint ever since I was a little kid, and to actually work in clay, the plastic arts as well. And so that was always, there was always an interest in there. And I knew I would go into the arts in one way or another, visual arts, when I was a little kid. It's about 40 years ago, I was in my first art school. And in that environment, I actually got some exposure to stone carving. There was a wonderful professor there. It was a little college called Montserrat that still exists up on the North Shore. But at that time in the 70s, the mid-70s, it was about 70 students and about 8 or 9 instructors. It was a much different institution than it is now, and than anything else that I know of. And one of the instructors, the sculptor instructor, was a stone carver. And he taught me some basic techniques back when I was 19 or 20 years old. I moved on and went to places where I really couldn't do stone carving, but I still remained an artist. I still drew and I still painted, and I worked as a commercial artist in New York City for almost 7 years. I then went to Rotterdam and I worked and lived and continued my study in Rotterdam in the Netherlands. I came out and I went back into the graphic arts field for probably close to 20 years. But I always did my own art when I could. And through this all, I came here to Arlington eventually. I raised a family. I worked for many years in around here as a technical illustrator, doing line art drawing. And I still do that on occasion. I find that as an artist, you need to be flexible. And so it's kind of like just all these things accumulate. So getting back to the sculpture, about 12 years ago, I kind of had a career transition. I kind of got out of the high-tech illustration world. Things were changing in that environment, and the work was not as consistent. Then I began, again, with this instructor of mine who taught me some stone carving techniques. We reconnected and I went out. One thing that he did to support himself was monument conservation in cemeteries, public spaces, anything that had to do with monuments needing to be restored. And I went out and worked with him.
So this was the same instructor.
And so when I first knew him, he was in his early 50s. At this time, I go back and reconnect with him about 12 to 15 years later, so he's in his late 70s. I work with him until he decides he really can't go out there and do the field work anymore, and I kind of took over a number of his locations and kind of and worked on my own. And so another facet to this is I'm doing a lot of the conservation. The conservation exposed me to some beautiful, beautiful stone carving work. And that kind of reignited something that had been there for a long time. So I started carving again. And I started doing my own work, and I started doing commission work. And it's been growing over the last 12 to 14 years. I think about 02 I went, started, 02, 03. It's just been developing. And so this is some of my work, and I work, although I can work in all types of stone, and a lot of my conservation work entails working with marble, I love to work with granite. And the reason granite is very hard and can be difficult to work with, but granite is very durable. Once the piece is finished, it can go into any environment, indoor, outdoor, and with a minimal amount of maintenance, and it lasts indefinitely. I love the material. I personally love what granite does, how it responds to the tools, what's inside of it. You can see that this is, I don't really know where this particular piece came, what type of granite this is. I got it from a building site in Providence, Rhode Island at one point. But there's just so many variants. You see the different shapes and colors of granite and the way that it responds to the light and the shadow. And for me, sculpture is something I love working three-dimensionally, and I love pulling shapes out of stone. It's much about the surface, it's much about the depth, the light, all the transitions within a piece of stone. I never cease to be fascinated. And in the process of doing it, there's just, it's amazing. It's almost a high. The most important and the most enjoyable aspect of this is the process, even and the most challenging while I'm working on a piece. When it's done, it's kind of like, it takes on a different life. I mean, I like some of the pieces, but there's not that intimacy there was throughout the process of creating it. And I'm almost a little bit, mournful sometimes when a piece is finished and there's no more to do to it except to work it too much. And that's something you need to always be careful. I think a lot of people in the arts struggle with this, is not overworking something.
Yeah, I was actually going to bring that up because I've talked with other artists and they tell me that it's hard to know when it's done.
Yeah.
And sculpture seems as if it would have that same sort of challenge, and yeah, it seems like it does.
Yeah, and that's a process. I think over time you get better at knowing, gauging when the time is to cease working on something. But you will surprise yourself sometimes. Sometimes you think, well, I can just get more out of it, and then you realize you've gone beyond the tipping point, and you really start to remove something that was in that piece that really was very magical. So just find that balance when you would stop. And depending on the type of stone that I'm working is how far I might finish it. For example, this has some polish to it. That's why, and the polish makes the stone darker. I won't polish this. This is, the grain of this won't allow me to polish it. So I have to not try and work it to that point. This is a rough piece of stone, and it looks very nice rough. It has some porosity to it. It has a beautiful grain that runs along, straight, it's along there. And I probably won't bring it to any more of a finish than this. And then I will actually go back in and work some more texture into this concave area as it goes on. As it develops, it gets tighter. And what is my process? Well, it varies on the particular piece of stone that I'm working on. Some things are really very well planned out in advance. This particular piece is just something I'm doing. It's something I'm working on currently. And this is basically all I'm working from is a little plasticine maquette that's about 2 inches high. I want the freedom to allow this to develop. This is kind of my template, but I'm not adhering to this. I am not scaling this up so that this will be exactly as that little model. That's something I do sometimes, and I can show you examples where I've done that. And I will actually use a pantograph sometimes.
What's a pantograph?
A pointing machine.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't have one with me, and if you want to come back, I will actually set it up. But for example, this little lamb up here, This is a model that I used, and there's actually some film on my, a little film on my website, and somebody filmed for the Advocate one time when I was working on it about 7 years ago. A customer wanted this for a monument, and so this is the working model, and these are points that I took. And so with that pantograph and transferred that to the stone, so when I finished the final piece, it was an exact replica of this model.
I got you, okay.
So, because the image can get lost in all the stone, as you're cutting and chopping away at the stone, things can get lost. So you need those reference points when you're replicating something. So these are things that I do on my own. This might give you this, some things along the wall. These are commissioned works for people. So this one and this one, not that one.
So you want to tell me a bit about the piece on the right?
The Leaf Man?
Yeah.
The Leaf Man is kind of an academic piece, but it will go into a garden. I can give you some light on that.
Sure.
Because you can really then see.
Oh, yeah, wow.
And that's a classical. I did that from, my reference on that was, actually a plaster cast. So that's not my original design.
Okay.
There you go. That's much better.
That's great.
The stone is just a raised ohm that will go into somebody's garden. This is a commission. The number is for somebody's house number. I do a lot of that for people.
I see. Yeah, I see
this one here. And then, I don't know, this is a monument I've done for somebody over the winter. And I worked with the client. And we came up with this design. And let me see if I can get you some light onto that, because that makes, again, with sculpture. Okay, so we came up with the design for the shape, and that was then honed by a vendor up in Barrie, Vermont. This is Canadian, you can see the difference in this. This is Canadian pink granite from Quebec. It came back to me. This had been sandblasted in. Basically, I cut this area in and I cut the flowers in. And this is what I had to work from for the flowers. And this is basically this woman's son drew this picture when he was 15 years old as a Mother's Day card. And they wanted that transferred to the monument. So this is something I love to do, is to do personalized memorials for people. As was the lamb, was a personalized. So the son's drawing as an adolescent has now been transferred to his mother's monument.
Nice.
And this will go out to a cemetery in Northampton in about a week. And there's a base for it over there. So that pins onto the vase and it will stand upright into the vase. I love doing memorial work. I love the conservation of damaged memorials and then actually creating them. And it's a way of also earning an income with your art. And
right.
If you're willing to be flexible and willing to cobble all kinds of things together, you can do it. It's difficult, but it's fascinating. They've always say there's the old adage that it's a great way of life, but a lousy way to make a living. Well, that's true to some degree, but if you're flexible you can and willing to use your skills and apply them to just about anything, I think you can make a decent living at it.
So we're talking about your commission pieces, but I guess what you're about to show me now is not a commission piece?
No, this is not. This is just one I've done on my own. And I acquired this piece of granite, and I had it for years knowing what did I want to do with it. And originally, it was part of a rounded curbstone. And this is a piece of just common variety Westford granite that you see that your curbstones are made from. And so over time, I looked at it, and basically, it started with doing the back of it first. And so this developed, but not this much. And I...
And so you started with the back.
I started the back, and that was finished, and this wasn't, and I didn't. And then this kind of evolved, and it kind of pulled together, and the title of the piece is Sun and Clouds. So the clouds are behind, kind of covering, and then this kind of sun iconography.
So let's go back to this back part, though, because forgive me for saying this, but I don't see much going on in the back. So what was going on in the back here?
When you say...
Well, I mean, when I look at it, I just don't see much in the way of carving.
There was quite a bit to get this form of a human backside in here that was very, very rough. It had been an old curb, rounded end of curb on a street. It had been pulled out. So this took a while to develop. So this is kind of a backside, a little bit androgynous, but
I got you. Okay.
I'm usually working from a female form.
Okay, now
I see
it.
The spine here.
I see it now.
Yeah, yeah. If you come this side, it becomes more defined.
Okay.
And then we have the front of it, which is that face. There you go.
All right.
That's the beauty of sculpture is also that, unlike a lot of two-dimensional art, a drawing, and I love to draw and I love to paint, the light is so important. It makes it almost a different piece.
Right.
And that's a dynamic that the plastic arts have that I don't see anywhere else.
Right.
So I'm constantly moving this lamp around while I'm working to see how things look from a different vantage point visually. And it can sometimes... Yeah, change the whole design, the whole process.
Right.
And this is another piece that I haven't titled it yet.
Right.
It has something to do with some tension. One thing I love to do, because people think of stone being so angular and cold and not organic, I like to find organic forms within a very material that a lot of people don't associate with being organic. So this is a piece of Quincy granite that I'd found, and I love working in Quincy granite. It's local. It doesn't hold the detail as well as some of the others because of these big specks of biotite in the stone. It just has a resonance in it that I like to work with it. So whenever I get it, it's really coveted for me, whatever my source may be for to get it. I don't have a real working title at this. It's just kind of like it's twisted. It started from this little maquette, like a lot of my other work. This one has the two faces on it.
I like that.
Yeah. The other one is, this one is the more serene of the two. And this basically is intended to illustrate the transition of a thought or feeling from kind of like very tense to very serene, and just how it twists and go along. So you've got another face on this side. It was intended to be a bit more tense.
I got it. Cool.
Yeah.
Nice.
And this is a piece of beautiful green granite. I'm not quite sure where it came from.
Yeah.
It's just I've seen it before. I'd never worked it before. And as you can see, this is a very, very tight green granite. And these are two halves of a female form that are just kind of, they're stored here, but when they're spaced, they're supposed to be in transition. So this is the front and the back. They're kind of folded, just as they're floating through. And I don't know if you can get over there, Len, with the with the camera. That's allowable on Arlington cable, but it is just a form. There's nothing else. Come from a very traditionally trained, even though the school I went to explained earlier, was very traditionally oriented. We learned to draw. We drew from the figure at least 3 hours a day, 5 days a week. So at 19, 20 years old, life drawing from the model, you learn to draw the figure and appreciate what it was. And it is still my fundament in all my art. even though some of this stuff would seem non-related, it is very related. And I still go out and draw in a studio situation with a model, usually about once a week. It's kind of like doing scales if you play an instrument.
I got it. Interesting. All right.
And so that's always my base for whatever I do. And so I always try to, no matter how non-seemingly illustrative a piece might be, there are elements always in it that that do reflect that traditional artistic training that I have. And so I can do this, but I also can do like the face of the leaf man. I understand the structure of a face or of any other anatomical part. So, and I like to meld the two if I can. What else?
Well, I know that you have some art, you know, around town outside. So
yes,
so we're going to go and check out some of that. We are taking a look at some of the work that you've done outdoors.
Outdoors, and we're right here in Mount Pleasant Cemetery in Arlington, not far from my studio. And this is a memorial I did about 8 years ago for somebody. And the story behind it is, with the open book and the glasses, was this particular person, Robert Scribner, was a professor, a history professor, specifically dealing with the Reformation, and that was his field and field of expertise. And he was a very popular lecturer at both Harvard and Cambridge College in England, where he was before that. His lectures were well attended, so he passed away, and his widow wanted something done personalized. She didn't want, even though his field of historical expertise was the Reformation, she didn't want a scroll like the treatises or anything. She wanted something to reflect that. So we collaborated and came up with an idea, an open book, which you often see on many stones, possibly a Bible, but not necessarily. Rendered in a way that was to look like a book would have looked like in the era of the Reformation in the 16th century. So we have these clasps, a lot of books clasped together. The book is offset. She felt that was appropriate for him. And he wore these very, very thick glasses. And I actually took a pair of his glasses and worked a model from them. So anybody who knew him would recognize the glasses. And what the symbolism is here is though he has finished the lecture, removed his glasses, left the podium, and stepped beyond. And that was kind of what they were trying to convey. So something dealing with that, so that his spirit is somewhere, wherever we go, and this is what's kind of behind it at his memorial. And so you can see it needs to be straightened. It was hit by a branch, unfortunately the branch did not break anything. But I love doing these for this type of work for people.
Yeah, it's very nice.
Something where I can transfer my creativity into something that is illustrative of somebody's life, and it's permanent. It gives a unique. I mean, there are a lot of beautiful monuments here, but sometimes you choose from a catalog what type of type of motif you'd want on it, and they do a good job. But it's a little bit industrial, and things like these are not. So sometimes people want something that is uniquely personifies the person that they're memorializing.
Well, thank you very much for sharing that.
Okay, you're welcome.
On our way back here, we passed the piece that you're working on and some of the equipment. So why don't we talk about some of the equipment you use?
Okay,
and can
sure.
Show us how you do some of it.
I just came from work. So here's a couple of things. I don't know if you want to pivot up. This is a dust collector. Even though you see a lot of dust around here, this does pick up a lot of it. Some of this dust is left over from when I cut. Which I won't do, but I'm going to open up my tool cabinet, and I have a number of saws, but this is a very small one. So it's diamond sintered blades, and I might do this to rough cut things first. This one reaches down about an inch and a half, but I could go down into the stone. I won't turn it on now, it throws up a lot of dust. But that's a way that you make some cuts, and then you take that off with a regular hammer and chisel. Later on, this is a grinder, so I might be grinding some of the surfaces. I don't use them that often, but there are, you know, this is a diamond wheel that I would might use for some detail. If I were to do hair on the dog, for example, I would use this tool. What I mostly use, getting back, I hammer drills to split. This is a bushing hammer to actually make texture on the stone. I don't use it that often. I usually use the pneumatics. And then, of course, when I split, you're using these wedges and feathers, which is old stone splitting technique. So my basis are these guys here, which is what I wanted to pull out. And these are pneumatic hammers that go into the airline, and right. Then there's a regulator behind them. And basically you put the chisel in here and you work the exhaust in order to get it to hit softer or harder while you're running it. Excuse me. So the chisels, they go in, but they're not, they're just in here and the piston bounces against them. They don't right. lock in like a hammer drill or anything like right. that. They're just there, so you need to hold them all the time. And I usually hold them like this with my pinky behind it because right. it's a better way to control.
Right.
And so it's kind of like a little bit like a trombone. You would move this back and forth to get it to hit, you know, harder or lighter. And you can have some control by putting your thumb on and off the exhaust.
So, well, maybe we'll see you in action
yeah.
a little bit. So.
Okay. Right. Okay, so what I'm doing here is I'm actually, this is a 4-point bushing chisel, and this is what you would use with a pneumatic to rough out areas. Once you've done your cuts and taken anything away with the hand tools, this would be your first step in getting a finished surface. So you can see it's taking away a lot of stone very quickly, and the 4 points work that out. And then I'm going to move on. So I'm getting into, you can do some fairly detailed shaping with just this tool. And this is using the one-edge hammer. So now, okay, I'll let it go for a minute. Just smoothing that out, taking down some of the high spots, getting a uniform texture down there close to the bottom, and then I bring it up. And that's basically it. You guide it, and you just let that hammer hit it, and you move it in and out depending on how hard you want it to hit. So if you're very close to something detailed, you'd move it further away from the piston. And that's kind of why I have it locked in my hand, kind of claw-like. Okay, I'm going to now switch to a different. So this is a smaller pneumatic tool, and I'm now going to a cup chisel. And what the cup chisel does is that will smooth things out even more. So you can see where that edge is kind of a little square. Now I can round that down a bit with that cup chisel. And it's just basically shaped like a cup with carbide, but it does take down some of the rougher, the bumps. And this starts to get the area more smoother. And I'm seeing something in here. Now this is what is two-pronged bushing. So I'm bushing with this. And this is even taking it down, making it even more smooth. So, and more finished. So there are many, many different chisels you use. It just isn't one type. There are all different facets and type. And I think this here is, I'm using, right, the three-prong tool to take away some of the rough surface in between those cracks. And correct, I believe I'm looking for a small flat, and that would be in order to, okay, actually that's about an inch. So I'm going to slow it down, and this is going to, the purpose of this one, it's wider, it's smoother, and it's going to smooth some of those edges. Again, this is all a process as you build up, you go from larger to smaller hammers. The smaller ones, they work faster, they hit faster, but they don't take away as much as material, so you can actually do more detail, more delicate things, where with this going at this speed, you're still in kind of a roughing out stage, even though I'm starting to get into some finish work along that crease. It's still very much in a rough stage, and that's why I'm running the tool fast. Now, as you can see, I'm slowing down the regulator because I want to get in there more detail, so it's now, there's not as much air coming into the tool and I have a lot more control. It's not hitting as hard. This is in order to avoid breaking that part where it rolls up there. So I can get in there and work at it, and it's safe. That area is protected. Where if you're using the 4-point, it's bouncing all over the place. It's a lot harder to control. So as I get closer to the finished part of it, then I am going to I'm going to want to exercise more control, and that's one of the ways you do it. So back to a small 4-point up there. I must have seen something that I still wanted to take down a lot more material to get that to roll just right into transition back into the stone in just the right way. So I will work back and forth. I even might go back and do some cuts with the saw, so that's like starting all over again. However, and I have to go through all of this to get there with it.
So I noticed that so far all you've shown me is work that you've done using mechanical equipment. And so have you always used mechanical equipment?
I actually started out just with two chisels in a hammer that I actually, when I restarted about 13 years ago, that I got off of Amazon. I had a piece of marble about this big and that wide and that thick, and we lost a dog, and I wanted to do a garden memorial for the dog, so I ordered the set, and I think it was $39 for a hammer and three chisels, and basically I carved a sleeping dog out of marble and all by hand with those three tools. And later on I bought things. This is a stone file called a riffler. Wouldn't use this much on granite. You could, but it's really meant more for the softer stones like marble, brownstone, limestone. There I use a lot more hand tools. I have a whole plethora of hammers and chisels right here, and I do use them, all different sizes, mostly for breaking things off when I'm roughing something out. Various hammers, all different weights and shapes. And I use those quite frequently, and very often, in fact, if you have a second, if I wanted to texture something, I might, if I wanted a rougher texture, I might just do that. And in some pieces like this area here, it's all done with hand tools. Okay. On that one.
Right.
So it's all hand tool.
Interesting.
So it's a combination of both.
Nice. Well, this has been very interesting, and I've learned a lot about you, of course, and about sculpting in particular. So thank you very much for
thank you for stopping by.